So this week's Fearful Symmetry Friday is going to come from Chapter 4, and it's called A Literalist of the Imagination, and this is Section 2. It's going to touch on a few interesting topics, such as what preserves a society. Is culture preserving a society, or is society preserving culture? It's going to end up in the City of God, which Blake calls Golgonooza, and Frye has an interesting idea of how that's constructed. And you're going to see some phrases that are coming up during Bush's funeral about the obligations of the nobles. And you're going to see some things that that remind you of Jordan Peterson, of course, about chaos and order. And so I thought this was an interesting page and a half to quote to you. So I'll begin the reading. The totality of imaginative power, of which the matrix is art, is what we ordinarily call culture or civilization. Everything worth doing and done well is an art, whether love, conversation, religion, education, sport, cookery, or commerce. Because the world is fallen, we think of art as ornament, succeeding necessities. But all life moves upward to achieve ornament, for ornament is free, and necessities are necessary. And here's a block quote. The Bible says that cultivated life existed first. Uncultivated life comes afterwards from Satan's hirelings. Necessaries, accommodations, and ornaments are the whole of life. Satan took away ornament first. Next, he took away accommodations. And then he became lord and master of necessaries. End quote. And this culture is what maintains all order and security in society. Reason and order being, quote, the bound or outward circumference of energy, the imagination is always constructive, and all interference or anarchy is of the selfhood. The essentials of the free state were defined in America as life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. But one cannot pursue happiness. One must pursue something else that will give happiness. And the only happiness that exists is derived from the free creative life. A state is free, then, in proportion to the amount of free life it permits, just as it is a slave state in proportion to the amount of death or imaginative restraint for which it is organized. Just as reason is the circumference of energy, so necessity is the circumference of freedom. Noblesse oblige. Penal codes and repressive laws cannot produce order. They are conceived as a desperate defense against chaos. Order is not a matter of morality, but of morale. Compulsion and obedience follow the anarchic will of tyranny. Our imaginations, being one in God, achieve, when unrestricted, a spontaneous cooperation. That is part of what Blake means when he says that empire follows art and not art empire. This conception of culture as the source of order in society and as a more complete in its appeal than religion, may remind us to some extent of the book Culture and Anarchy, enough at any rate to make us wonder why so strongly Hebraic a thinker and despiser of the classics as Blake should hold such views. Blake believed, like Arnold, that culture preserves society. He did not believe, as Arnold apparently did, that society preserves culture. Society, to Blake, is an eternally unwilling recipient of culture. Every genius must fight society, no matter what his age. Arnold's view of both culture and society is conservative, traditional, and evolutionary. Blake's is radical, apocalyptic, and revolutionary. Arnold thinks of the prophet not so much as a visionary as a preacher of moral scruples, and in his thought, the boundary line between Hebrews and Philistines become even more vague and fluctuating than it was in history. Inspiration is the artist's empirical proof of the divinity of his imagination, and all inspiration is divine in origin, whether used, perverted, hidden, or frittered away in reverie. All imaginative and creative acts, being eternal, go to build up a permanent structure which Blake calls Golgonooza, above time, and, when this structure is finished, nature, its scaffolding, will be knocked away, and man will live in it. Golgonooza will then be the City of God, the New Jerusalem, which is the total form of all human culture and civilization. Nothing that the heroes, martyrs, prophets, and poets of the past have done for it have been wasted. no anonymous and unrecognized contribution to it has been overlooked. In it is conserved all the good man has done, and in it is completed all that he hoped and intended to do. And the artist, who uses the same energy and genius that Homer and Isaiah had, will find that he not only lives in the same place of art as Homer and Isaiah, but lives in it at the same time. I thought that was a great idea there that Frye puts forth and that Blake apparently kind of buys into about art and the creation of the New Jerusalem, the city of God, through art. And, you know, I think you can kind of read some of Peterson into that, especially if you look at his talk that he gave, I think, at some kind of art museum in Toronto. It was maybe a year and a half ago. And that's all I have for this week regarding Fearful Symmetry. It's a nice short reading, a nice little something to think about. If you like this sort of thing, please give the video a like and subscribe. Thank you.